All right. Hey, Jeff, welcome to the podcast.
How are you, Kyle?
Man, I'm good. I'm excited to share your story and learn a little bit more about you. Did we connect through, was it Brian Bogert?
Yeah.
Brian that Bogert, was it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. He's a good guy. All right. So, and I was on your podcast and then now you're on mine. I've just enjoyed getting to know you a little bit. So this will be fun. I want to dig into your story, serial entrepreneur, doing a lot of things. Before we were hitting record, you and I were talking for about 20 minutes about real estate and things like that. So I was just joking. I should have recorded that, but you've got a good story, a great story. And, I love that you're a husband, a father, and an entrepreneur. And so I can't wait to get into that as well. So before we do that, a couple quick hitting questions. Okay.
Yeah. Shoot.
All right. Where were you born? Where is currently home?
Both. Toronto, Canada. Toronto, Canada. I was born and raised in Toronto, Canada. I'm living about 20 minutes northwest of there now and more in the suburbs. But yeah, Toronto, Canada is my home, and it always has been. It's a great, great city.
What is going on in Toronto, Canada right now?
Today is May 18th, if I'm not mistaken. And it's a complete shit show, Kyle. I don't know if this is when this is released or not. And Toronto, Canada, I don't understand what the government's done. It's we're so behind on vaccines. It's a complete shit show due to COVID, but I would say it's more due to how the government is kind of conducted their business in the winter. We're the only province, the only place in the world that they stop skiing, which you're wearing a mask, you're wearing a helmet, you're skiing by yourself, you're outdoors. Why would you stop skiing? Now in the summer, they decided to stop golf and every outdoor activity. Schools were at a 99.5% COVID-free, but they decided to close every school for the year. We're on a complete stay-at-home lockdown order right now. Mm. It makes absolutely no sense. And as a business owner and a guy that really works his ass off to help small businesses and help small businesses thrive, it's hard seeing that over 12,000 small mom-and-papa restaurants across Canada have all locked their doors, over 500 gyms across Canada have all locked their doors, which it's the rollout effect. And I don't think people really understand. They go, okay, sad, a gym closed their doors. But now you look at Jeff Lopes, I provide them with equipment. Guess what? Now I'm affected. Mm-hmm. Now my manufacturer is affected. I buy raw material from a separate factory and then I bring it to my factory. The raw material guys, it's a snowball effect, right? Mm-hmm. And it's affecting millions of people, and the livelihood and the businesses are just, it's sad seeing everybody struggle. And it's all they keep doing is trying to put band-aids on things. The government just keeps putting band-aids on things, thinking there's somebody there, put a band-aid, throw a little money that way. But all they're doing is putting us in more debt at the end of the day, because all they're doing is giving loans to businesses. People are great. I got a loan. We got to pay that shit back. Mm-hmm. Government doesn't give you nothing for free. Let's be realistic, right? That.
Yeah.
So all these people getting loans and getting this, they don't want to manage it, right? If you don't want to manage those loans, you're not bankrupt now. You're going to be bankrupt later, just in more debt. That's the only difference. So long story short, we're in a pretty shit spot right now, economically, because of the government not really understanding how to regulate and how to deal and deal with this whole COVID situation properly.
I just last night talked with someone else who was in Toronto, and it was a similar amount of frustration and, what are we doing here? So I feel for you, man. So growing up, who made the biggest impact on you?
Oh God, man, we're going to go there right now. My dad, as we were talking prior, my dad just passed away, less than 2 weeks ago, May 7th. And, God, he was my hero, because he literally was the type of guy that could grab his hands and do anything. He never took an electric course. He grew up in restaurants growing up. So he was a head chef. He came to Canada. He was a head chef at a really, really five-star resort, kind of restaurant area. And from there, he ended up, for financial reasons for the family, ended up going to work at Ford Motors, because it was a really good paying job, and everything was about protecting his family. And hard worker, did everything with his hands. That guy could build a house with his bare hands, and always there for his family, man. He really, I realized later on in my life, and it took me probably the last maybe 3-4 years, how I really took time as a currency, and I realized how wealth is measured by freedom, freedom to do things you love, spend the time with the people you love. And when I sit back, and years ago, I realized this, when I sat back and thought of my dad realized that he was a blue collar, hardworking guy working at Ford Motors. He could have had so much more, because back then you were making great money working at Ford Motors. You're making like 33, 34 bucks an hour plus. But if you worked on weekends or after time of time and a half, you're making overtime, time and a half. Weekends, you're making triple time. He never worked a weekend, never worked overtime. He would finish a shift, come home to the family. He was never miss a sporting event, always the family. So he could have had nicer cars, nicer houses, nicer everything, but he didn't want that. It was all about family time. And he understood that. And hands down, he was my biggest influence. I mean, he was my rock. And man, it's been a rough, losing him it's been a rough last few weeks, because he was a big, big part of my life, and still was, even till this day. Like I talked prior, I mean, I'm 44 and I talk to my dad 2 to 3 times a day. Like, yeah, he was a huge part of my life, right? So it's anybody out there listening, man, appreciate your family, appreciate your loved ones, because shit is taken away from you so quickly and so unexpectedly sometimes. And live with no regrets, man. Spend time with them, tell them you love them, talk to them, do stuff with your family, do stuff with your loved one, do stuff with your friends, because it takes one phone call and everything changes.
Your dad sounds a lot like, your relationship with your dad sounds a lot like my relationship with my dad as well. And my dad is similar. He's a carpenter, so he could build whatever it is. And oddly enough, I have zero of that skill. I never learned it from him, but I want to stay there for a second, because you're a father, right? You have two kids. How old are they?
13 and 15 now.
How has your dad influenced you as a dad with your two kids?
God, I mean, as you become a dad, you evolve and you build your own methods and your own processes and your own ways of fathering. But I mean, unconditional love, like my dad was always there. My dad was always and I call it the yes factor with my kids, right? If my kids ask me to do anything with them that involves time, whether you want to go for a walk, you want to go for a hike, you want to go play catch, anything, tell me with my homework, anything, everything else, Kyle, is done. I shut everything else off and I spend time with them. And that was something my dad did. I remember as a kid, I'd be like, Dad, I need this. Okay, let's go. Dad, take me here. Okay, let's go. It was never a question. In my head, I took that for granted. And I understand that now with my kids is like I said, I call it the yes factor. And just understanding how to build, one thing I took from my parents and I've adopted into our family is road trips. I'm a huge, huge fan of road trips, because I think there's nothing more special than sitting in the car and driving for 12, 14, 15 hours, and everybody's screaming, everybody's annoyed, kids are throwing up in the car, people are nauseous, people are just angry.
Yeah.
But you know what? When you sit back and think of those memories, like I did a road trip 2.5 years ago, we went to Myrtle Beach, from Toronto to Myrtle Beach, about 19 hour drive. And we were there for 4 or 5 days. And on the way back, we were gonna stop in Virginia, crash out for the night, split the drive. So we did that on the way there. We split the drive. We're having so much fun in Myrtle Beach, and such a great little spot. We're having so much fun there. And I looked at my wife and like, you know what? Instead of splitting the drive, let's cancel the hotel in Virginia Beach. Let's spend one more night here, enjoy the beach, enjoy the stuff. I'm gonna suck it up and drive straight on the way home. So I did that. It was literally about a 21, 22 hour drive.
Oh,
left at 5 a.m. and just gunned it home. Back was killing. We almost hit going through Virginia, man. We almost hit like 2 or 3 deer in the middle of the freaking dark. My kid Tiago threw up like, I think 3-4 times, a car smelled barf. It was my back. I was stopping, trying to stretch my back out every freaking half an hour. But you know what? Those memories, my wife was just taking pictures in the car. When you look back at those, and those are some of the funnest times. We just laugh, enjoy ourselves. And that was one thing with my parents, like, I can't remember, from a very young age, my parents, every summer, my dad would always block off 4 weeks in the summer off. He would block all his vacation time to 4 weeks. And we'd jump in the car And we'd have the, my dad would have the car, parents would have the car packed. We'd wake up about 2-3 in the morning. We'd be sleeping on the floor, wake up 2-3 in the morning, half asleep. Me and my sister throws in the car, hammered down the Cape Cod. And we've spent usually around 3 weeks on the beach, a little cabin on the beach every summer. And that was our summers. Yeah. And that was like, oh my God, some of the best memories, like crazy memories. Mm. And that's something I've taken from my dad, was I try to build these, we try to do two road trips. COVID obviously changed it last year, but we try to do two road trips every single year. And we build it around things our kids do. My son's a huge baseball one. So every summer we build it, we hit a baseball stadium. So we did Yankee, we did Fenway, we did Pitts, we hit a baseball stadium. But my daughter's the dance one. So we find it around a really high-end studio, and I let her to do a really private dance class at a high-end studio. My son does the baseball, and then we join and we enjoy the city with the wife, right? So we build it around everybody, but road trips, man, do road trips and take lots of pictures and develop lots of pictures.
Yeah, I remember road trips was a thing of our family too. We used to have a station wagon with a wood panel on the side, you know, where you sit in the back and you face backwards. Like that was built for road tripping. That's cool. You talked about the concept of time and currency and building that into your life. How have you been able to do that? Again, before we hit record, you were talking about how you are, you're in real estate, but first of all, where did the concept come from? Like, what is that? Why is that important to you? And then how have you been able to execute that in your life?
Oh, man, there's so many different layers to that, right? When times of currency, how I executed it, I'll talk about that in a sec, but I mean, it all really began, and I'll quickly go through the story. Like, I'll give a little Coles note of the story. 13 years ago, I was a typical entrepreneur. I was working crazy hours. I was super successful. I was making tons of money. I had everything you think of, but I didn't have a home life. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was very disconnected with my wife. My daughter was a year and a half old. I was not a present dad. I thought I was a present dad, but I wasn't a present dad. I would go there, bring home the gifts, do what I had to do to put a smile on everybody's face and be there at live events and be like, hey, I'm a great dad. I'm a great husband. But we were very disconnected, me and my wife. We wouldn't talk. We were very disconnected. She was 31 weeks pregnant. And it was a Friday afternoon when we got rushed to the hospital. And it was emergency section. I almost lost my wife and my son the same night. Mm-hmm. And it, just to, for the audience to understand the magnitude, I was put in a room where the doctor looked at us and said, my wife was knocked out. She got a really bad infection. She was knocked out. After the emergency section, I was put in a room. They were giving respiratory to my son. They said, you got about 5-10 minutes left to your son. And do you have a name for him? We didn't even have a name for him. And the first name that came to my head was Tiago, which means God's warrior. And I just wrote that down. And that is essentially what his journey started. And for the next 4 months of his life, we are very fortunate that Sick Kids Hospital is one of the greatest hospitals, pediatric hospitals in the world, is in our home here in Toronto, Canada. And that became his home. That became our home. And he became my purpose. Mm-hmm. Nothing mattered but getting him out of the hospital, Kyle. And for God, in that 4 month period, we almost lost him 4 or 5 times. He had 6 organs that are severely damaged. His brain was severely damaged. And at 4 months old, I looked at my wife and we got to take him home. We can't, this is not life. We got to get him out of here. And I somehow convinced the doctors to discharge him. And he was only 4.5 pounds. He fit in the palm of my hand at 4 months old. He was on feeding tubes, hadn't swallowed in his life. So we were sent home with a little 1-ounce bottle, and we had to teach him how to swallow. We had put food in his mouth. His reflex, he would spit it up. We did that for weeks and weeks. And when we was discharged, he would give it a diagnosis, a quote unquote label of cerebral palsy. And they said he would be most likely, because his brain damage, confined to a wheelchair his whole life. And that's essentially when my journey started. I mean, that's when I was just like, I couldn't understand, or I couldn't come to a conclusion that I could see my son suffer his whole life. And I thought, you know what? I have to give every single effort, every type of financial, every type of resource I possibly can to give him the best opportunity as possible. We didn't know his future, but I had to give him that best opportunity to have the best future he possibly could. And that's when a lot of the things started doing, where I actually, for the first time in my life, I actually started saving money. And fast forward 4 years later, I bought my first piece of real estate. And they were all essentially for my kids, because it was a situation where I didn't know his future. And that's when our journey started. And we took everything as a win. When he first smiled at like 6 months old, my daughter dropped something in the kitchen floor and he smiled. Huge win. That was just like, we were all crying when he first when he first balanced himself at a year and a half old, that was a huge win. And I was spending 3-4 hours a day stretching him, therapy, trying to get him to walk, doing everything. And we finally got him to start walking, and I convinced the doctors to put him on AFO braces. And they said, once he adapted to the braces, they were up to his knees. They said he would probably be in braces when he's 19, 20. And he would always have difficulty walking. And that literally just fueled me even more to make sure he could get out there. And we said, I mean, if you go to my son's room where I have pictures, I would set goals on his walls, like literally huge pieces of paper I'd stick on his wall and be like, we're going to hop on 1 foot. And that took like 3 months every single day to hop on 1 foot. Mm-hmm. Everything is these massive goals. And we set a goal 5 years ago, and I'm so happy my dad was around to see it. 5 years ago, I said, by your 12th birthday, you're going to be out of your braces and you're going to be running a marathon. And we put this on his wall. And his birthday was April 19th and April 18th. For almost a year prior, he was out of his braces. April 18th, we ran a marathon together. And so it was a huge accomplishment. And my son's fully out of his braces. This kid's an absolute beast. He sprints, he runs, he's a workout fanatic. And so that became my journey. So long story to your question is, I really honed in to understanding what my purposes were. Okay. And when I mean purposes, everybody can, I know people are like, oh, you have one purpose. I'm a strong believer you can have multiple purposes. I have a purpose to see my business. I have a purpose for my real estate. I have a purpose to have a relationship with my wife. My son was a purpose. So he was one of my main purposes, but I understood in order to make these purposes actually really viable is I had to really focus my schedule, and I learned how to time block, and I learned how to put the non-negotiables in my schedule before anything else. So I figured every single month, these are my non-negotiables: helping my son walk, helping building a relationship with my wife, spending time with my daughter, spending time with my family. These things, my dad, my mom, were put on my schedule. These are my time blocks. These are my schedule. These things are not moving. They're non-negotiable. And then I would build my business around that. And then when I sat there, I'm like, okay, I don't have enough time in a day. So what do I have to sacrifice? So I figured out, okay, I'm going to be up at 4:30 every morning. Not because I like to. I fucking hate waking up at 4:30 in the morning. Everybody has those morning aha, like, oh, get up and do your yoga. I can't stand it, but I do it because I realize if I get up at 4:30 in the morning, Kyle, yeah, I can get a shitload done before 9 o'clock. And guess what? Now I can be home from 3 to 7 every day because I call it 3 to 7. I'm home every day from 3 to 7. 3 to 7 o'clock is my family time. And things, life changes, but you'd have to understand that time block. Now that my father passed, I've been spending my 3 to 7 from 4 to 5 every day. I go down to visit my dad, and that's my hour with my dad every day. So it's understanding what parts of are non-negotiable in that time of your life and putting them in your schedule and making sure they're not taken out of your schedule. And look at your schedule, study your schedule, figure out what areas you can sacrifice where you add more time in the evening, more time in the morning to make sure your goals, because you still have to run a successful business. You still have to make money. So it's not all about family. You still have to provide. You still have to, the bills are still not going to go away. And if you want a certain lifestyle, you still have to work for it. But at the same time too, if your schedule is so jammed, then study your schedule and figure out what shit could come out of your schedule. Which people in your life are draining you? This shouldn't be in your life. I do a dump every 3 to 6 months. I look at my inner circle, my life, people around me, and I figure out which people are really wasting my time. And I'll literally cut them out of my life. I focus on the people who are going to bring me energy. They're going to bring me good vibration. They're going to give me the support I need. The people that I know if I support them, they're going to support me back. And once I figure that out, I figure out which people need out of my life and what things in my life that are really wasting my time that I don't really have to put energy towards. Right. And then because new things always come up, new people come into your life. So being able to kind of understand where to deplete and where to add is very, very crucial to living a good filled life, right?
I love that. Thanks for sharing and unpacking the journey, especially with Tiago. And you wrote a book, right? You're an author. What's the book?
Yeah. Entrepreneurial Dad.
Entrepreneurial. Did it, and that was born from Tiago's story.
Tiago's story. You know, what's crazy is I had given the book to my dad, and I wrote the book a year ago. And my goal is, and I always set goals as a parent, and I think this is very important for parents to understand, is I set goals. And in 2020, I set a whole bunch of goals, and I always show my kids because I wanted them to be winners. I want them to be in their head that if they set a goal, they get accomplished. I always set my goals, and I hold myself accountable to my children. I say, listen, dad's going to do this. this is what's going to happen. So I said, I'm going to write a book. We're going to be a number one seller in this many categories. And we did. We wrote a book 11 months later, number one seller in 11 categories. And but I set a goal and I set these. But I had to get, my dad was so proud that I wrote my book, and I'm writing a second book now. So when I wrote the book, I gave it to my dad, and life got busy. He started doing it. He never read the book. So as I've been going to visit him every day, and I actually been reading a chapter of the book to him. Mm. And as I'm reading the book, I had totally forgot what I have, half the shit I wrote there. And it's crazy is I talk about my dad in the book about 4 or 5 times. Mm. So the book is lessons that that any entrepreneurial dad or parent, be honest, could really take and use to have more of a, and I know all these entrepreneurs say, oh, don't use the word balance. There's no such thing. There is a such thing as fucking balance. I am a strong believer that you could balance and have a good filled family life and a good filled business life. It's just that people have a really hard understanding with the word balance, but you could have a balance and understanding of it both. And it's the book was written to help parents, but it was also to put a little outlet of my son's story. And a lot of it has to do with just family stuff, right? Just understanding family value.
Mm. And you kind of outlined a little bit. Well, first off, the book's on Amazon, right? So the listener can grab it on Amazon. 100%. Okay. So, and you outlined a little bit about balance, though, because you talked about what are your non-negotiables, what's important in your life, schedule that into your life, look at maybe from time to time, counterbalancing, maybe almost when you use the word, and say, what's not serving me? What do I need to get rid of? Because things always get added to our life, but rarely do we go through and say, this probably needs to be cut. This needs to be gone. I need to delete this. So I like that. You gave it the framework there. Is there any other way that you found that the listener can find or attempt to get balance or rhythm or harmony, whatever it is, or integration? What are some other ways that you've been able to do that?
I multitask. I multitask a lot, right? So that allows more freedom for your time. Like when I look at the white spaces on my schedule, I utilize those white spaces. Those white spaces are calling loved ones, calling friends, people I haven't talked to in a while. I also utilize family time to do multitask. So as a family, we do fitness together. So when I get home, especially now the kids are homeschooled because of everything that's going on in this world, I get home and we do an hour and a half to 2 hour outdoor activity every single day as a family.
That's cool.
So we literally will go for a bike ride. We'll go for a hunt. Like yesterday we had the kids in the park. And we took them up the street to, we have a really big park by our house. We went up the street and we had family races. Like me and my wife were sprinting, trying to beat each other. She was going full out. Like we had races. We had about 15 sprint races together. And we do stuff as a family. And that way we're actually multitasking. We're doing something healthy. We're bonding. We're spending time with the kids. So we're multitasking. So you could multitask. I work out with my son 3 to 4 times a week, 5 times a week, lifting weights. Like it's understanding what parts, what things in your life that you could multitask, and you could, you know what, if instead of seeing my parents and seeing the family, to have once a week, everybody together, like multitask, learn how to join things together that are necessities or non-negotiables, but you could time them and slot them together to make them work together. So you have more free time. Right. And everything too is I think this is something we didn't even talk about, but is as much as I put family and business, I still put my health above everything else, Kyle. Mm. Like I'm a strong believer in your health has to be your number one priority. Cause if you're not at your peak level health-wise, you're taking your vitamins, you're not resting, you're not working out. If you're not at your peak, how are you going to serve everybody else? How are you going to have energy? Like everything I've been through in the last week and little over a week, with the loss of my father and trying to keep everybody happy. And I've taken charge of the whole family dynamic. And I'm now essentially taking care of two families because I'm dealing with my sister and my mom and trying to help them. If I was out of shape and I didn't take care of myself, there's no way I would have the energy to do this because I'm emotionally destroyed. Right. So being able to take care of yourself. And the last thing is I try to take a vacation every day. And what I mean by that is I try to figure out 15 to 20 minutes a day. And that's my time. And be honest, the last 9 days, 8 days since my father passed away, I've done that too. So my time of just understanding, relaxing, just breathing, and is been spending time with my dad. And that's my time that let's unwind and just, so figuring out a certain slot in your day that you're doing something that you love, something for yourself, something to fulfill you, something to fill that cup up. So you're always energized. So figuring out something that you do, whether it's going for a hike, whether it's you love cars, work on your car, whatever you love, find something and slot in 15, 20 minutes a day and do that for yourself. Okay, because you have to be able to also take care of yourself, because you're never going to be able to fully, if you're constantly giving, you'll eventually drain out. And I went through this in the past, so I understand it. This is coming from experience, not just like this 100% experience. Like I went through that more than one occasion where I was just giving, and just, it crashed. And now I understand that I need to give back. I need to take care of myself physically, mentally, spiritually, but also give back a bit. So I'm able to, okay, you know what? This is my time. Now I'm ready to serve others.
My wife always asked me to go for a run with her. So back to your point of multitasking, and I'm always like, I cannot run with people because when I run, I'm a mess. Like I can't talk. Like I'm out of breath. I'm just a sweaty beast.
Yeah, but it's also just being present.
But that, and I think that's what she's getting at. Like I don't have to have a full on conversation with her. I think she just wants to,
you know,
to
be around. Me and my wife, every single night, this is our time. This is almost like our daytime. Every single night when the kids are put down, we'll literally go for a good kilometer, mile walk, whatever you want to call it, Canadian American. So we go for a mile walk around the blocks, about 4 or 5 laps around the block. And that's our time just to unwind, talk about the day. And lately I turn into a fitness because I bought a weighted vest. I'll slap a weighted vest on. So I'll make it a fitness thing. But it's I'm walking around, everybody thinks I'm Arnold Schwarzenegger in Commando with this black weighted vest walking around. The neighbors are looking at me like I'm crazy. But it's just our way of just it's usually around 9:30, 10 at night. It's already kind of getting dark, and it's our way of just our time to talk, our time to connect, our time to say, how's your day? Ask questions, which a lot of people don't do. Ask questions, communicate. And I think that's a huge part of our relationship. Every night we just say it's locked in Monday to Friday, not weekends, Monday to Friday. We go for our walk, especially the weather's nice now. We go for our walk.
How else do you take care of yourself? So you mentioned health, fitness is a top priority, but how do you execute on that personally? What are maybe some hacks you do, things you do that you found to be really effective for you to maintain peak levels of energy and performance?
I mean, I'm a huge supplement guy. Like I love my supplements. I have, God, I put on my storyline. I take God, collagen, probiotics, megas. I take it's a whole turmeric. Like I take about 13 pills every single morning. I pop 13 pills in my mouth, glass of water. I also am a huge believer in intermittent fasting. So I intermittent fast. So the last meal is usually around 8 o'clock. I don't eat nothing till about 12:31 the next day. I only do that Monday to Friday because I'm a strong believer too that intermittent fasting could slow your metabolism down. So what happens on weekends, I enjoy breakfast with the kids. I just shock up my body. But Monday to Friday, what happens is, and what I've studied is intermittent fasting, your body can only do two things at once. It's either digesting food or healing. So if you're feeding your body constantly, you're not giving it time to heal. So I'm a strong believer in giving it time to heal. So I'll have my black coffee. That's the only thing I'll have. And it allows your body to heal properly because we do need time to heal. So intermittent fasting, I do take my vitamins. I work out with my son. I try to do some form of resistance training 4 to 5 times a week. And then we do cardio with the family. So I when it comes to fitness, and then I do power walk my wife. So we're always doing something activity wise. Sleeping, is something I've struggled with for years. I'm not a good sleeper. I try to, I preach to everybody else, but it's like something I struggled with years. And sleeping I think is very important, but it's something that I, like I said, no one's perfect. I struggle with my sleeping patterns very, very much. I'm a very restless sleeper. And so that is one thing. But in general, it's just being able to unwind. Like I, even like on weekends, there are times when I've learned to understand my body. So there are times like on weekends where I'm just like burned. And you know what I'll do? I will literally put on a movie like Jason Bourne, something I've watched 30 times, or Rocky IV that I've watched maybe 40 times. And I'll put on the movie and I'll watch it. And because I don't want to put on a new movie, I'll watch it because it's something I've watched so many times that I don't have to focus on it. And I'll have a meal. I'll sit down, have some pot. And that's my time. Just dump, just like, who cares about the world? So having those dump moments too, they're okay too. because your body needs those dumb moments too. So it's something where I want to put myself in a situation where I don't have to think. I'll turn off my phone. I don't have to think. And even, like I said, my 3 to 7, when I get home from 3 to 7, obviously now with my dad, it's a little different. It's the last couple of weeks, but I turn off my phone. Like, I'm present. Like, I haven't missed dinner at home with my family. Now when I get home, like, they're waiting a little longer for me to get home to have dinner with them. But if we haven't missed dinner at home Monday to Friday for, God, 11 and a half years.
Wow.
I'm home Monday to Friday for dinner every single day. And it's just certain things that are in my schedule that fulfill me, and they just balance me out. And I think I need those things to ground me, right?
Mm. Your intentionality and approach to life is refreshing to hear, especially as someone who is a husband, a father, an entrepreneur. You've got a lot of stuff going on. So there's a lot of, it'd be easy to have a lot of excuses for reasons why you don't show up the way you do. So it's refreshing to hear that. So I want to be sensitive to your time. Just looking at the clock here. Let me ask one more question as we kind of close it up. Jeff, what is one piece of advice that you tend to give out the most?
Really, I mean, wake up every day and do something you love, man. Just have a passion for what you do. I mean, we go through life, and I think a lot of people go through life numb. Mm-hmm. And you always hear the same thing, Kyle, is people have the most regrets on their deathbed.
Mm-hmm.
God, I tell people this, and this is something I think we've talked about. This is, write a living eulogy, man. Write a living eulogy, and it's something I even do in my podcast. I have to ask everybody, like, how do you want to be remembered? It's writing a living eulogy, understand of how you want to truly live your life, and then reflect on your life. Like, look at your life. Like, are you doing the job you really have a passion for? Are you spending the time with your kids that you truly want to do? Are you doing the hobbies that you love? Are you spending the time with the people you truly love? Are you wasting it on social media? There's so many things that people do every single day, and they become numb to it. And sometimes you really have to sit back and just literally pull off the whole NLP neuro-linguistic program, to sit back and push everything away and just, like, look at your life, like, watch it. Are you truly living the way you want to live? And if you were to go today, do you feel fulfilled? Do you feel like you've done everything you really want? So really analyze your life and wake up and do. And it could be working for somebody. It could be a job. You don't have to be an entrepreneur. But if it is an entrepreneur, are you doing the career you want? Are you running the business you want? Are you happy with your employee? Like, make sure that everything in your life you're doing has a purpose to making you a better person, and has a purpose to you serving others and helping others along the journey. Because you could live a whole life of having everything in the world, but if you haven't helped people along the journey and succeeded other people along the journey, you're going to feel unfulfilled at the end of the day. So just really, really focus on what you're doing and make sure you do love what you're doing. And the last thing is, I tell everybody this all the time, is make sure you love yourself first. I think a lot of people are at that stage of life where everything's so fast paced, with social media, with the world, with your kids, with your families, and go, 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 go. And they don't take the time to really, really spend the time to love themselves. And it's hard to truly, really love something if you don't love yourself first. So make sure you really love what you're doing. You love who you are. And then everything else has come together after that, buddy.
Mm. Really good. Jeff, someone can grab the book on Amazon. What's the name of it again?
Entrepreneurial Dad. Can't get more simpler than that.
Okay, I love that. And then you on Instagram are just simply, what's the
Jeff,
what's the
Jeff at Jeff Lopes, JFFLOPS. And it's just it's trying to just serve and build as much as you possibly can, right?
Yep. And the podcast,
Jeff Knows Inc, where you'll catch Kyle in a couple weeks on there.
Yeah. All right.
His episode is coming up soon.
That's good. Well, Jeff, I appreciate you taking time to share and talk. And it's been great getting to know you, and I look forward to continuing it. But thanks for coming on today and sharing.
Thank you, brother.